Let's go to Jose's. We always go there to celebrate.
I don't have many older women come visit, but sure, let's talk about the Golden Girls. In 1985, the Golden Girls dared to show us that life for women after 50 doesn't end with shawls and rocking chairs. The four women of this Miami household lived with adventure, humor, and long stories of lives still being lived. A success from the very first episode, the Golden Girls carved out a space on Saturday nights for one of the most powerful ensembles seen on a sitcom. Running for 7 seasons and winning 11 Emmy Awards, including one for each of its leading ladies, the Golden Girls was a huge hit. The idea for the Golden Girls was inspired by a joke. Back in 1984, NBC aired a special called the NBC All-Star Hour, which was used to promote upcoming shows for its 1984 season. One of these new programs was the cop show Miami Vice. Selma Diamond and Doris Roberts were on stage introducing the show and jokingly called it Miami Nice.
This is a show about sitting on the beach.
No, Selma, honey, no. This show is not called Miami Nice. This is called Miami Vice.
In the midst of a long night of boring promos, these two women were a breath of fresh air, and watching that night were network executives who were struck by how funny they were. Warren Littlefield, an NBC executive at the time, recounts the story.
And we continued to marvel about just the comedic chops and the attitude of these two 50-plus women, these actresses. Golden Girls started as this kind of internal discussion of it doesn't have to suck to be a 50-plus woman in America.
NBC approached producers Paul Younger-Witt and Tony Thomas with this rough idea of a sitcom starring older women. The two producers then approached writer Susan Harris to create the concept and write the first script. Harris had found success having created shows such as Soap and Benson, but Golden Girls would prove to be her biggest hit. When it came to casting, the Golden Girls was tapping into a talent pool that had largely been ignored, actresses over the age of 50. Littlefield explains.
50-plus women were not being given jobs in television. They certainly weren't starring in feature films. We had our pick.
Susan Harris wrote the character of Dorothy as a Bea Arthur type, though ironically, Bea Arthur was the last member to join the cast. According to Arthur, she had heard rumors about her starring on a new sitcom before even seeing the script, but once it finally made it into her hands, she was sold on it.
Finally, I was sent the script. It was like nothing I had ever read before, and I just thought, what a great script, I'm gonna do it.
Arthur would play Dorothy Zbornak, the smart, sarcastic, and cynical member of the group. A substitute teacher from Brooklyn, Dorothy serves as a sort of leader for the quartet of women, often offering advice that is both sage and brutal in not-so-equal measures.
He left me 38 years later for a stewardess that he met on a business trip to Hawaii. It was her first flight. They said on arrival, give the passengers a lay. She got confused.
Rue McClanahan and Betty White were originally considered for opposite roles. Betty White was originally considered for the role of Blanche, the salacious Southern belle, because of her work as Sue Ann Nivens, the saucy housewife on The Mary Tyler Moore Show.
You're the most voluptuous, exciting, desirable creature on God's earth. With admiration and lust.
Rue McClanahan was asked to read for the role of Rose, the earnest, simple-minded housewife from Minnesota. McClanahan had played a similarly demure character on Maud as Vivian Harmon.
I happened to look at my passport picture, and then I glanced up and I saw the picture of the cab driver. Maud, I was the spitting image of Leo Pilsudski.
When reading for the role of Rose, Rue McClanahan was asked by the pilot director, Jay Sandrick, to read for the role of Blanche, unaware that she had been hoping for that role instead. Rue McClanahan recounts the story.
I was reading Rose for Jay Sandrick, obviously without my handle, and he said, I'm going to ask you to do something unorthodox. Will you go down the hallway and just look at the role of Blanche? I said, well, surely if I have to.
When Betty White was brought in to read, she was asked instead to read the role of Rose. And though she wasn't too excited about the prospect at first, she grew into the role. Blanche Devereaux is a Southern belle who owned the house the four women lived in, a gift from her late husband. Self-absorbed and a relentless flirt, Blanche seems to know every man in Miami, and she would be proud to say that not a single one of them has ever forgotten her.
When a beam of moonlight hit my cleavage, suddenly, the band began to play. It was at that moment I realized my bosoms had the power to make music.
Rose Nyland, originally from St. Olaf, Minnesota, is a former housewife who moved to Miami after the passing of her husband. Sweet and caring, Rose is the most innocent of the women on the show and has a talent for missing the point of most conversations, turns of phrase, or basic instructions.
This old woman was in the mirror. I didn't even recognize her.
Who was it?
The last member of the quartet was ironically the first one cast. Estelle Getty was a relative unknown at the time, though she had recently made a name for herself in the play Torch Song Trilogy. She had spent most of her time in small productions in New York City, and that play was her first real taste of major success in acting after working in the field for decades. It also brought her to the attention of Hollywood, and she found herself chosen for a role on The Golden Girls. Sophia Petrillo, Dorothy's mother, was a former resident of the Shady Pines retirement home. Having recently suffered a stroke, Sophia was blessed with the gift of saying whatever was in her mind at the moment, whether it be an old story from her youth in Sicily or a snappy insult towards one of the other women. Most of the time it was an insult.
Every morning, like clockwork, at 7 a.m., I pee. Unfortunately, I don't wake up till 8.
This quartet of women would be the principal cast of The Golden Girls throughout its 7-season run. The only slight exception is that in the pilot, they were joined by the character Coco, the gay housekeeper, played by Charles Levin. The original concept of the series was to focus on the characters Dorothy, Blanche, and Rose, with Sophia and Coco in supporting roles. However, Estelle Getty's performance as Sophia was so strong that it was decided to instead make more room for her in the series, and Coco was cut from the cast. Although Coco does appear in a handful of scenes in the pilot episode, many of his lines were cut, and all later episodes were rewritten to remove the character entirely. Although this might have seemed ominous for how the show would include LGBT representation in the future, the series instead featured a number of gay characters throughout its run, and became a favorite among gay audiences. Throughout the series' run, there would be countless guest stars, but The Golden Girls was unique in that the four central women carried much of the comedy in the series on their own, with guest stars often complimenting them rather than providing standout performances. There were some recurring performers, such as Herb Edelman as Dorothy's ex-husband, Stans Bornack, Harold Gould as Rose's boyfriend, Miles Weber, and flashbacks featuring Sid Melton playing Sophia's late husband, Salvador. But the focus of the series was always the four stars, presenting older women in a way that hadn't been seen on a sitcom before. The Golden Girls debuted on September 14th, 1985, with the episode The Engagement. Although following episodes would make some meaningful changes, notably dropping the character of Coco, much of what we see here is how the show would work throughout its 7-season run, only with a slightly different interior layout of the house and a better wig for Estelle Getty. In very quick succession, we meet Dorothy, Rose, and Blanche, each one establishing who they are in a few easy lines. Blanche introduces the plot for this episode, that her boyfriend of a few weeks, Harry, is proposing to her. With Blanche possibly getting married and her owning the house, Dorothy and Rose are worried they might not have a place to live. Things get more complicated when Dorothy's mother, Sophia, arrives.
Ma, what's the matter?
Everyone is fine. No one died. The home burnt down.
It's decided that Sophia will be staying with them, at least until they figure out if Blanche is going to be getting married or not. This episode also marks an interesting bit of censorship from the network. After meeting Blanche's boyfriend, Harry, Sophia says,
"The man is a scuzzball."
Originally, she had called him a douchebag. As the series would progress, the show's status as a hit would allow it to push the envelope further, though there would always be pushback against certain words referring to female anatomy or hygiene. After that insult, Rose sums up one of the central concerns of the series.
"I mean, we get married, we have kids, the kids leave and our husbands die. Is that some kind of a test? Our families are gone and we're alone. And there are too many years left and I don't know what to do.
Get a poodle."
An entire series of older women struggling to find meaning in their lives doesn't sound like a whole lot of fun. But in spite of Rose's misgivings, the ladies on The Golden Girls managed to find quite a bit of life left to live through the series' run. This episode in particular introducing another shot at marriage for Blanche.
"Blanche, are you going to marry Harry?"
"Marry Harry, marry Harry."
"A little rhyme."
"Knock it off, are you?"
"Yes, next week."
Blanche lets Dorothy and Rose know they can keep on living with her until they find a new place. And while it looks like these women will be split up just as soon as we met them, we learn something about Harry.
"God, he's been killed."
"Arrested."
"What?"
"He gave me this to give to you. He's a bigamist, ma'am. He's wanted in 4 states. He's got 6 wives."
Blanche is heartbroken, but sometime later, she's able to leave her room.
"I was feeling good because of you. You made the difference. You're my family. And you make me happy to be alive."
The dynamic between these women, their personality, and the theme of creating a new life in an old age are all clear and vibrant throughout this episode. It would establish the how and why these women are living together and the way in which their relationships with one another are so meaningful. Very few sitcoms, before or since, feature a cast entirely made up of older women. It also dares to give these women meaningful lives in spite of the stereotypes about them, and it does it in a way that feels completely natural. One aspect of the script that's so interesting is how these women have lives they've already lived. What would normally be clumsy exposition, Dorothy mentioning her ex-husband Stan or Rose mentioning her dead husband Charlie, feel like natural reminiscences.
Charlie, on the other hand, moves all night long. His side of the bed looks like a murder took place.
Rose, Charlie is dead.
Why tell her?
Blanche's impending marriage makes for the perfect prompt for both Dorothy and Rose to mention their husbands, and the way they speak reflects not only how the two characters remember their marriages, but their attitudes towards love and romance in general. Being able to reflect on life by telling stories of the past is a natural way of learning who these characters are, and it would be a recurring device used in the future, particularly Rose with her stories about living in St. Olaf.
I haven't been this scared since 1952, when St. Olaf's most active volcano threatened to erupt. Well, luckily, there were some druid priests who were in town for the opening of Stonehenge land. And they said they could stop it if they could sacrifice the town's dumbest virgin. I don't know why I raised my hand.
We'd also regularly hear stories from Sophia about living in Sicily, Blanche living in Georgia, and Dorothy growing up in Brooklyn, each one revealing a part of that character's past that connected them to their story in the present. The premiere of The Golden Girls was an instant hit. It was number one in the ratings for that week, even beating out The Cosby Show. It managed to do that in spite of being broadcast on a Saturday night, which, at the time, was a difficult night for TV sitcoms to find any sort of audience. But the strength of the series was impossible to ignore, and it would finish as the seventh most watched show in the United States in 1985.
What is it this time, Stanley? Whoopee cushions for the hearing impaired?
When describing the dynamic between the four women on the show, Betty White said they were like four points on a compass. Rose herself described it in one memorable clip.
Dorothy, you're the smart one, and Blanche, you're the sexy one, and Sophia, you're the old one, and I'm the nice one. Everybody always likes me.
The old one isn't so crazy about you.
More than just being the smart one, Dorothy has a piercing wit and sharp insight that often allows her to cut through the nonsense around her with a sarcastic comment. In the second episode of the series, Guess Who's Coming to the Wedding, we get a sense of just how strong a presence Dorothy is when she learns that her daughter Kate, played by Lisa Jane Persky, is getting married, and Dorothy has to deal with her constant foil, ex-husband Stan.
Rose, I'd like you to meet my ex-husband, Stan Zbornak.
Hello.
And this is his hair.
Stan, along with his toupee, are constantly torn apart by Dorothy. She clearly does not take crap from anyone, least of all the man who ran out on her.
You all right?
Oh, she's a trooper. She'll be fine, won't you, Dorothy?
Not until I taste his blood.
This episode is ostensibly about Kate's wedding, but the real marriage of interest here is Dorothy's, and how she never got any closure from how Stan ended things.
You walked out on me, and you didn't even have the decency to tell me you were leaving.
Dorothy, look, things happened.
Things happened. You're damn right things happened. 38 years happened.
You can tell Bea Arthur is used to performing on a stage the way she confidently walks through the set, which also establishes how she has control over the small man sitting down. While this might have all been leading to Stan apologizing for his wrongdoing, it instead ends with Dorothy taking charge.
But now you're here in front of me, and you can't run away. And I finally get to have what you tried to cheat me out of. I finally get to say goodbye, Stanley.
Look, Dorothy, we...
I said goodbye, Stanley.
This is a whole episode of Dorothy crushing Stan, and it only ends when she gets what she wanted, the right to say goodbye to him. Had Herb Edelman not been so great in the role of Stan, this certainly would have been the last we would have seen of the character, as it was Dorothy turning the final page in her marriage, one she made sure she would be turning herself. Being an older woman is tough, and maybe that's why these older women are so tough themselves, though they also take time to show these characters in a vulnerable state as well, which makes them seem richer and more fully developed. Dorothy isn't just some boring cliche of a strong woman crushing a man. Throughout the series, she would prove herself to be something far more three-dimensional. In most episodes, Dorothy is the level-headed one, capable of seeing the injustices in the world around her. But in many episodes, that persona is flipped as she often finds herself falling into the pitfalls she so easily spots others stumbling into. In season 1's That Was No Lady, we see Dorothy in a romantic relationship with a man named Glenn, played by Alex Rocco. And though he seems like a great match, Dorothy is shocked to find out a secret about him.
I'm married.
What?
I couldn't leave her because of all the things we're going
on. Oh, look, I don't want to hear about it. Oh my God, I'm storming out to the bathroom.
Seeing events unfold from Dorothy's perspective give Glenn the chance to appear more sympathetic, as this is still a man Dorothy loves, but she shows her own integrity when she walks out on him after finding out the truth, though this doesn't last.
So, you started up with your married man again.
How did you know?
I'm the amazing Kreskin. I was listening outside the door.
Oh, Ma.
Oh, I can't put my ear to the door, but you can put your...
Ma!
Blanche, Rose, and Sophia offer advice, and perhaps because of that, Dorothy comes to a conclusion.
Things aren't working out anymore, and I don't know what to do to make them any better. You can't leave your wife, and I'm not cut out to be the other woman.
Dorothy does much of the heavy lifting here on her own, but key to that is the counsel of her friends, and it demonstrates that whatever strength Dorothy may have, even she isn't infallible and needs a bit of support and a reality check from time to time. Dorothy is the embodiment of a modern woman in the 80s, in charge of her life, but still trapped in a world that won't give her her due. She grew up in an immigrant household, achieved her dream of becoming a teacher, but still had to struggle after becoming pregnant as a teenager, going through a bad marriage, and now just managing to get by on the salary of a substitute high school teacher. It's hard to say if her strong will was created in spite of or in response to a world that isn't always welcoming of women. But whatever the reason, it becomes most apparent that there are forces working against Dorothy taking full control of her life in the season 5 two-parter, Sick and Tired. It opens with Dorothy feeling unwell.
Cannot get rid of this flu, and it keeps getting worse, not better.
But it's been months now. Maybe it's not the flu. Flu doesn't last that long.
Dorothy has already seen two doctors, both telling her that she's fine, but she can't seem to escape this feeling of exhaustion.
Dorothy, you've got to see another doctor. Raymond is not a specialist.
Yeah, but what kind of specialist do I need?
Well, just call up Dr. Raymond, ask him. He'll refer you.
You have to, honey. You're getting sicker and sicker.
Things don't get any better with a visit to Dr. Stevens, played by Jeffrey Tambor.
All I can think about are my test results and how to keep this gown closed.
Don't worry about it. You won't be needing it. Dorothy, get dressed. You're fine.
I beg your pardon?
So Dorothy tries another doctor in New York, played by Michael McGuire, and he doesn't think anything is wrong with her either. But he does make a suggestion.
Take a cruise, Dorothy. Go to a hypnotist. Change your hair color. My wife became a blonde. She's a new woman.
Dorothy's frustrations start to boil over.
Nobody believes me. Everybody thinks I'm crazy. Maybe I am. Maybe I'm really crazy.
Oh, Dorothy, you are not crazy. I mean, you are absolutely not crazy. I've seen the way you walk. I've seen how wiped out you get. You're not crazy, honey. You're sick.
Dorothy's situation is difficult, though it would have seemed so much harder if she didn't have friends like Rose reassuring her that she isn't losing her mind. And what I particularly like about this two-parter is how it shows that her illness isn't something that only affects Dorothy. It's something her friends feel alongside her.
She can't do anything anymore. So what difference does it make that they don't have a name for it yet? It's still something. There were lots of diseases they didn't have a name for. You think they had a name for the Black Plague when one guy had it? Thousands had to die before they knew what it was. Dorothy could be dying and they just don't know it.
In the second part, Dorothy's friend, Harry Weston, played by Richard Mulligan, finally offers some kind of meaningful direction for her.
So do you think I'm crazy too?
Dorothy, I think you're very sane. Just because a doctor hasn't found something doesn't mean there isn't something there.
Are you serious? Well, how come you know that and they don't?
First of all, dear, I know you. You're a stable person. And if you say you're sick, you probably are sick.
What's particularly sweet is this line.
Has he been your doctor ever since you were little?
He's not my doctor. He's my friend.
Dorothy visits Dr. Chang, played by Keon Young, who finally offers her some answers.
I think that you are sick. I think you have something called chronic fatigue syndrome. It's fairly recent. There are many theories about it, but most of us believe it's a virus. It just has not been identified yet.
The man's a genius. By the way, I loved Flower Drum Song.
After visiting at least 6 different doctors, Dorothy finally has a name for what's been affecting her. And while this scene does get a bit exposition heavy, it does offer some important insight into an illness that can often be missed by doctors. And later, we get some explanation as to why that might be when Dorothy confronts one of the doctors who dismissed her.
There are a lot of things that I have to say. Words can't express what I have to say. What I went through, what you put me through. I can't do this in a restaurant.
Good.
But I will. You made me feel like a child, a fool, a neurotic who was wasting your precious time. Is that your caring profession? Is that healing? No one deserves that kind of treatment, Dr. Budd. No one. I suspect had I been a man, I might have been taken a little bit more seriously and not told to go to a hairdresser.
And she ends on a powerful note.
You'd better start listening to your patients. They need to be heard. They need caring. They need compassion. They need attending to. You know, someday, Dr. Budd, you're going to be on the other side of the table. And as angry as I am, and as angry as I always will be, I still wish you a better doctor than you were to me.
And the two-parter goes out on a happy note. This is an episode that could only be done with Dorothy. She's someone so used to being in charge, and even when dealt a bad hand, she's at least able to acknowledge the circumstances and adapt, even if she may stumble here or there. In this case, the problem isn't Dorothy. There's no way she could be expected to deal with an illness she can't even name. She's completely at the mercy of the medical establishment that isn't set up to help her. It's by going through that medical establishment that she finds out that, as a woman, her concerns aren't being taken seriously, and instead she's written off as mentally unwell, something that's been historically true about the medical field for centuries, with illnesses that specifically affect women often written off as hysteria or some sort of mental imbalance. This is perhaps the strongest example of how the series highlights issues that affect women that often go without discussion in mainstream entertainment, at least in the 1980s. This two-parter was written by the series creator, Susan Harris, and they were inspired by her own experiences with chronic fatigue syndrome. In her words, "My experience with the medical profession during those years was something I know many people had faced, especially women. And if I, with my resources, was having the trouble I was having with doctors, I could only imagine what women without those resources or without that strength were going through." Since the series couldn't have Dorothy sick and tired the whole time, Harris explained that the audience had to assume Dorothy gradually got better. And while chronic fatigue syndrome usually doesn't resolve itself like that in the real world, it is something of a necessity in a sitcom that doesn't have the space to modify its premise by introducing a chronic illness, though that certainly might have been an interesting wrinkle to include. In that two-parter, we got a sense of Dorothy as a heroine, a role she fit into comfortably, and a role she would readily place upon others as well. In the closing of the Season 7 episode, That's For Me to Know, we find out Sophia had a husband before Dorothy's father, Salvador. She fled Sicily to escape the marriage, and she married Sal in America. Sophia reflects on it like this.
Dorothy, I went against centuries of tradition. You don't leave an arranged marriage. I disgraced my family's entire way of life.
I think I'm finally beginning to see.
Good. Then you'll have the decency to lie if anyone asks you about it.
But Dorothy sees it differently.
She single-handedly dragged her family into the 20th century by refusing to be thought of as property and demanding instead to marry a man she loved. To do so, she had to leave behind everything she'd ever known.
You make me very proud.
No, Ma. You make me proud.
I hope you're not waiting for a hug.
Now come here, you tramp.
Dorothy is very much the image of female strength, but it's important to acknowledge that her strength includes the firm base of her friends, and in return, she offers that strength back to support them. It shows how the dynamic between these women is a cooperative one, facing the challenges of a world built by men together. What makes Dorothy a leader among the four women is that strength she carries in herself and inspires in others, a strength necessary for older women in a world that increasingly tells them how irrelevant they are. One of the key ways in which we see this dynamic play out is in the series' signature cheesecake scenes, where the four women sit around the kitchen table discussing their lives over a dairy-based treat, first appearing in the Season 1 episode, Job Hunting, we see the ladies bring out the very first cheesecake.
I'm gonna have cheesecake.
Is there cheesecake?
Chocolate cheesecake.
Have you bought chocolate cheesecake?
For an emergency.
What kind of emergency? Nuclear war?
Depression.
Although this is the first time cheesecake was mentioned, it was not the first scene of its kind to air in the series. In Rose the Prude, we see the women sit around the kitchen table drinking coffee, talking about how they've aged.
Don't be silly. I look at my face all the time. How different could it be leaning over? Oh, my God! Oh, my God, Dorothy! Why didn't you tell me about this before?
Only on your back, Blanche. That way everything slides back and you look like you just had a facelift.
Oh, you're right. I'm gorgeous. I'm gonna have to meet men lying down. I thought you did.
This scene wasn't in the original version of this script, though when the episode wasn't coming together well enough, Susan Harris apparently wrote this entire scene in 1 hour while on a plane. This type of scene would become one of the staples of the series, where the women would talk about anything and everything. These scenes provide not just the opportunity for deeper characterizations for the focal point of the story, but the advice offered allows the other women an opportunity to shine as well, often relating the main plot to stories from their past. It also offers them the opportunity to explore topics and theme outside the scope of the events of the episode's plot. It shows how these characters relate to each other, not through their present-day circumstances, but through their past lived experience as well, offering the opportunity to contrast and learn from one another's history.
We have had a lot of great late-night talks right here.
Yeah, and most of them have been about sex.
Oh, well, of course we do talk about sex, but we talk about other things too. We console each other, we help each other, we advise each other, and then we talk about sex again.
These scenes also tended to garner some of the biggest laughs, sometimes from the actresses themselves. In the season 1 episode, The Way We Met, you can see Bea Arthur and Rue McClanahan struggle to keep a straight face as Betty White delivers a St. Olaf story.
Oh, not that kind of circus. A herring circus. Sort of like SeaWorld, only smaller. Much, much smaller. But bigger than a flea circus.
Mm-hmm. Tell me, Rose, did they ever shoot a herring out of a cannon?
Only once. But they shot him into a tree. After that, no other herring would do it.
Well, in the scene, Dorothy and Blanche are supposed to find Rose's story amusing, something that would very much change over time, but their reactions don't seem quite in character. It was so funny, they kept it in anyway, though, and it shows us the raw comedic power of these scenes. These scenes were so important that it was the cheesecake scene from Rose the Prude that was used when the Golden Girls were invited to perform on stage for the Queen of England at the Royal Variety Hour.
Rose, I already have friends I don't have sex with. You guys!
Blanche Elizabeth Devereaux is a character so synonymous with sex, her initials spell out bed. But to reduce the role of Blanche to someone who enjoys a good hookup is to miss out on how her character explores the world of love, romance, dating, relationships, and yes, of course, sex. One of the most common ways Blanche is described by her friends on the show is a slut. She even defends the label herself when Rose's own prolific dating history is revealed.
If that were true, Rose, that would mean you were a slut.
Oh, come on, Blanche, how can you say that? So the woman had 56 boyfriends in 1 year. She's not a slut.
Thank you, Dorothy.
She is the slut. She is the easiest woman in this room.
Dorothy Spornak, you take that back.
The slut is dead. Long live the slut.
Though the label itself isn't great, Blanche's embrace of it, when used by her friends, keeps it from really hurting her. There's only one instance where Dorothy calls Blanche a slut that really seems to hurt her, in the first season episode, The Triangle.
You could never be a real friend to another woman, and you know why?
Why?
Because you're a slut.
A slut!
After this, the word seems to have lost power over her, or perhaps it only lands here because it was in the context of a fight between the two of them. Although she is mocked and teased endlessly by the other women, it seems that Blanche does not take those words as marks of shame, but rather as good-natured ribbing. Even so, the character of this ribbing still reinforces the negative trope of feminine promiscuity and reinforces expectations around the proper role a woman should have in society. And in this way, it reveals how certain patriarchal forces have been internalized in the ladies of the Golden Girls. This isn't about blaming them, though, more like observing that they are products of the system they inhabit, and some of their behavior can reinforce the system, while other behaviors resist it. Blanche is a character who embodies both of those behaviors. There are countless references to the many, many, many men Blanche is involved with over the years. Although there are moments to suggest some of this is exaggeration on her part, we get several glimpses into how expansive her romantic life is when she seems to know a friendly male face in every new locale, or when she pulls out a set of keys to the apartments of her various lovers.
We're not breaking in, I have a key.
Some of these stories about Blanche's dating life are used to highlight her own insecurities, such as in the season 1 episode, Blanche and the Younger Man, where she tries to date a man named Dirk, played by Charles Hill.
I like the way you sound and the way you look.
Well, thank you, Dirk.
You remind me of my mother.
In season 4's Blind Date, Blanche dates a man she meets at a bar, John, played by Edward Winter.
See, I'm used to men liking me for my looks, at least partly. And you don't.
I sure don't. As a matter of fact, I'm glad I never have to look at you.
And in season 6's Stand By Your Man, she dates a man in a wheelchair, Ted, played by Hugh Farrington.
With a view like that, why, I bet you look out the window a lot.
Blanche, are you a little nervous?
Nervous? Me? Wheelchair.
In each of these episodes, we're not being told stories about accepting men as they are, but rather seeing Blanche struggle with her own insecurities and preconceptions of what it means to be an attractive companion to a heterosexual man. None of these trysts end well. Dirk was looking for a mother figure, John and Blanche never get to the point where they're even exclusive, and Ted turns out to be married. They're all easy ways to wrap up stories after the characters have served their purpose, offering Blanche a chance to get past her own preconceptions on what makes an ideal man and how that relates to her own insecurities on what it means to be the ideal woman. Perhaps one of the most interesting of these encounters is in season 2's Diamond in the Rough, where Blanche dates a carpenter named Jake, played by Donnelly Rhodes.
Oh, wait a minute, before you eat that clam chowder, there's just one thing.
What?
It tastes better if your lips are warmed up first.
I'm beginning to see why this place is so romantic.
The problem here is that Jake comes from a different world than Blanche, one of a lower class.
There's some things about him I cannot get used to.
Really? Like what?
Well, it's a question of breeding. He uses his fingers instead of his knife to push his food. He tucks his napkin into his collar. He wears white after Labor Day.
There's an irony here. Jake has his own catering business while Blanche needs 3 housemates to help pay off her mortgage. But Blanche can't let go of that image she had of herself in her earlier days growing up on her wealthy family's estate. And because of that, she can't find a way to be happy with a guy she adores. Something Jake is aware of after she pushes him away and tries to undo that when she sees him in a tux.
You were right. Blanche, I'm happy. I like myself. I want to share my life with somebody, but I want to share it with somebody who's as comfortable with me as I am with them. I don't want to go through life wondering if my tie's too loud or I'm using the wrong fork at dinner. I know. Tonight you said our differences don't matter. But they did before, and they will again.
Aside from the class differences, what this interaction also underscores is how Blanche isn't just someone looking for a hookup. When she sees Jake in a tuxedo, he represents the sweeping romance she's always dreamed of, something she had with her late husband George. Blanche represents a traditional view of femininity and its reflection in the desire of men. Instead of rejecting that dynamic, she instead leans into it, making Blanche a symbol of adaptation under a system that values her on the basis of her sexual appeal. We get a sense of what Blanche's marriage was like when George's brother Jamie, played by George Gizzard, shows up in season 5's That Old Feeling, and Blanche thinks she's fallen for him.
I'm in love with you, Jamie.
Well, Blanche, darling. I do feel something for you. I think maybe I always have.
I knew it.
But I don't believe it's love. Not the way you mean it. You're in love with a memory I brought back to you.
And in season 6, we are shocked to find out that George faked his death in Mrs. George Devereaux.
Blanche, honey, please.
Oh my God, what in hell? Why do you look like that? I don't believe this.
Blanche, who is this?
If I didn't know better, I would say my dead husband, George.
This stunning episode is tragically revealed to not only be a dream, but a dream Blanche has been having for years.
You know, usually I feel so empty when I realize George isn't here, but this time it's different.
How?
Well, I don't know. The dream was different. Oh, wait. I got to hug him. You know how I always wake up before I get to hug George? This time I didn't.
Although we likely don't see it as often because it doesn't get as many laughs as Blanche's sex life, Blanche is also a hopeless romantic. And for whatever she's done since becoming a widow, she was always faithful to George, even though the same couldn't be said of him after George's illegitimate son David, played by Mark Moses, arrives with the news of his infidelity in season 5's An Illegitimate Concern.
George Devereaux, your husband, was my father.
Get out.
There's a real sense of tragedy about Blanche, drifting from man to man, hoping to recreate what she had with George, but never quite finding it. And with the news of his cheating on her, she learns that the vision of the past she had held onto was a fantasy. If Blanche represents the classic image of a Southern belle draped in traditional femininity, she's also a revelation of how much of that archetype is an illusion. She meets a number of men and fixates on these superficial differences that make them appear less than ideal. And when she does meet a fantastic guy, she can't get over the fact that he doesn't exactly fit the image of who she thinks she should be with. And even her treasured memories of George are revealed to be, at least in part, an illusion. Blanche is the strongest critique of the society these women find themselves in, revealing gender expectations to be a tool to keep women envisioning themselves primarily as objects of desire for men, never quite realizing that these illusions will never come true, that Blanche will forever be waking up from the dream where George returns to restore her to her imagined life of wedded bliss. But that isn't to say Blanche is living entirely in a world of delusion. One thing very apparent about Blanche is that she is having a great time with her life, whether it's with the men she hooks up with, or in some cases, develops romantic feelings for. Blanche is enjoying love and dating in all its many forms. In that way, she has the space to break free from that fantasy and the chance to enjoy herself. Blanche is too complex for a simple label. She's both a critique of the Southern belle archetype and a celebration of all things romantic and sexual. She is both subservient to the expectations placed on women, but also creates an ownership of these expectations that let her find some happiness in her life. Blanche is also the vehicle that gives us some insight into abusive relationships as well. In season 3's Blanche's Little Girl, Blanche's daughter Rebecca, played by Sean Sheps, introduces her boyfriend Jeremy, played by Joel Rigobuto, to her mother. Jeremy is not a good guy.
So you ladies made a great meal.
Jeremy, as long as you're handing out compliments, you haven't said anything about my new outfit. You know, that's not very nice.
Well, I'm trying to be nice. That's why I didn't say anything.
Even though it leads to a fight, Blanche still feels compelled to tell her daughter,
"Open your eyes. I'm not beautiful. I'm not a catch."
Well, for that man out there, you certainly are. He's got you thinking that you need him, Rebecca. That's all backwards, honey. He's the one who needs you. You're probably the only woman on earth who's kind enough and caring enough to give him a second glance. He's not good enough for you.
Blanche very easily spots what a jerk Jeremy is, but she has trouble when the shoe is on the other foot. In season 6, the bloom is off the rose. In that episode, she's dating a man named Rex, played by Mitchell Ryan.
You remember my roommate?
What are you dressed for? We're going to a beach party.
Oh, I could have sworn you said the theater.
Once again, you're wrong.
Oh, well, I'll go change.
No, just skip it. We're late. This is so stupid.
Blanche only realizes the problem with Rex when Dorothy is the one to confront him.
Under all that makeup and sexy talk, there's a little girl there, and for some reason or other, she's letting you take advantage of her. I can't stop her from seeing you, but I'll be damned if I'm going to hurry her up.
Who do you think you are?
A friend.
This is none of your business. Just butt out.
You're hurting me.
Stop that!
In both cases, Blanche can very easily see abuse for what it is when it's affecting someone else. And the fact that she can't see it when it's affecting her says something about the sort of blindness that can affect someone who's fallen for another person. But more than that blindness, what these examples highlight is the importance of having a support network ready to help you realize you're making a mistake, whether it's through telling a person the truth, such as what Blanche did for her daughter, or defending a friend in the face of abuse, such as what Dorothy did for Blanche. For all the importance Blanche represents when it comes to love, romance, and sex, she also resonates with the premise of the series, the importance of friendship between these four women. She serves as the cautionary tale and aspirational figure when it comes to dating. No one wants to be thought of as Blanche, but no one is having as much fun as her either.
Hi, it's me, Stan.
Although the Golden Girls primarily focuses on the lives of the four women the series is named after, there is some commentary on men on the show as well. Stan Zbornak is the most commonly seen male face on the show, having appeared in 25 episodes out of the series' 180. He even has a signature catchphrase.
Hi, it's me, Stan.
He also has this tendency to break down in tears.
Now what's wrong?
I lost it, Dorothy.
You never had it, Stanley.
Stan is kind of a loser. Not because he's constantly crying, there is no shame in a man crying. Rather, it seems he only ever visits Dorothy when he's on the brink of tears, desperate for her help and comfort because something in his life has gone completely wrong. It's fascinating that the man we see most frequently on the show is constantly at the mercy of the women on it. It inverts the gender dynamics often seen in television, typically showing a strong man in control, and it offers the chance for women to be the source of strength and comfort. But it also gives the male character the space to be vulnerable. In the same way none of the women on the show have had their lives turn out quite the way they expected them to, Stan is a failed businessman who threw away his marriage for a younger woman who would eventually leave him. Although Dorothy has established she's ready to move on, Stan clearly has trouble moving on without her, and his appearances over the seasons reflect his need for having her in his life. It starts happening as early as season 1's Stan's Return, where Stan and Dorothy spend the night together, and while she considers it a one-off event, he thinks it must mean they're getting back together.
What happened the other night brought back lovely memories, but I'm not the same woman you walked out on 2 years ago. I mean, my whole life has changed, and quite frankly, I like the way it is.
As the seasons go on, though, Stan slowly begins to worm his way back into Dorothy's life, and surprisingly, into her heart. Stan shows some growth as a person in season 6's If At Last You Do Succeed, when he finally strikes it rich by selling the Zborny, a baked potato opener.
Zbornak and Zbornak, what a team. Maybe we can do it again sometime.
Maybe.
Thanks, babe. Dorothy.
And this leads to the two-parter, There Goes the Bride, where Stan and Dorothy nearly get married again.
Dorothy Zbornak is going to be my wife. I want to shout her from the rooftops. I just want to tell the whole world.
Me too.
But not your mother.
The wedding plans are dashed, though, when Stan wants Dorothy to sign a prenuptial agreement.
Marvin, give me the agreement.
Ouch! Weddings. Why do I always get hit at these things?
Get out, Stanley. Get out before I need a lawyer.
I think you got a case.
I've decided not to make the same mistake twice. I'm sorry.
Dorothy was mistaken in thinking that Stan had changed completely, and for her own sake, manages to avoid a second marriage with him. But what Stan's insistence reveals about him is the danger of living in the past. When he becomes wealthy, he sees it not as an opportunity for a new start, but for the chance to go backwards. It's not as though love can't ever be rekindled, but Stan wanted to go back to a time where he had the pleasure of being married to Dorothy without the obligation. During their marriage, it was Dorothy who took the financial hit, slaving away to support the family while Stan struggled to make a living as a novelty salesman. When the roles are reversed, and even without any children to care for, Stan can't be bothered to make the same commitment to Dorothy. Dorothy wanted a healthier second marriage where they were partners, whereas Stan wanted to go back to the first one, where he could take from her without having to worry about giving anything back. Stan's loss of status, leaving him vulnerable, represents the anxiety a man feels in the loss of said status. And he's an object lesson in that moving backwards is not a solution. The other prominent male character on the show is Rose's boyfriend Miles Weber, played by Harold Gould, who appears in season 5 and is dating Rose until the end of the series, with one notable break. Miles worked as a college professor, which made him an unusual fit for Rose, who wasn't particularly known for her scholarly side.
I feel so dumb around you.
Oh, never say that, Rose.
But you're a teacher. You think for a living.
You know, life's a ballroom, Rose. If you'll pardon the metaphor. If you hear something you like, don't analyze it. Just dance to it. You understand?
I think so. Except what a metaphor is.
There's an earnestness and honesty in the relationship that's in stark contrast to many of the relationships of Dorothy and Blanche. And that relationship completely falls apart when we find out in season 6 that Miles isn't who he says he is in the episode Miles to Go.
My real name is Nicholas Carbone. I was an accountant in Chicago. And my biggest client was the dead man we saw on the TV news bulletin this evening.
The cheese man?
That's right. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, you're a snitch.
No, I'm not a snitch. I'm an informant.
Oh, a snitch in a tie.
The point is, it all would have been behind me, but he escaped. The government had to put me in the witness protection program. Gave me a new name, new job, whole new identity.
The secret only came out once he believed the mobster known as the Cheese Man was dead. But when it's revealed that he's very much alive, and the Cheese Man is currently tracking down Miles, he has to go into hiding again.
Oh, I love you so much.
Rose, I love you too.
But I also love my friends and my family, and the thought of leaving... I'm sorry.
This is probably the most melodramatic ending of an episode of The Golden Girls up to this point, ending on Rose reading some poetry.
And when to the heart of man was it ever less than a treason to bow and accept the end of a love or of a season?
Miles would return a few episodes later, the mobsters chasing him would then be arrested, and he and Rose resume dating as they had before. But it underscores an important part of what makes Rose who she is. Though Rose is someone who values romance and relationships, she also reinforces an important part of the Golden Girls, the themes of family and identity, finding love and comfort in a family, and defining life on your own terms.
They asked me to name the seven dwarfs, and I did. But evidently I didn't name the seven they had in mind.
Rose Nyland, born in the storied St. Olaf, is the most straightforward of the Golden Girls.
It's like that old Scandinavian saying, you can lead a herring to water, but you have to walk really fast or you'll die.
Perhaps it's because of that simple nature that Rose is able to see beyond the traditions of what a family is supposedly made up to the more fundamental bond that is demonstrated throughout the series. A family is made up of the people who accept you. Even though only Dorothy and Sophia are related by blood, all the women of the Golden Girls consider each other as family.
You all are not related?
Oh, no.
Really? The way you were teasing and talking to each other, I thought you were family for sure. Isn't that something?
It shows us that sometimes a family is about who you choose to be closest to rather than someone you're related to biologically. This is particularly true for Rose, as we learn in the season 4 episode, You Gotta Have Hope, that she's adopted.
There's something I've never told you girls. I spent the first 8 years of my life at the St. Olaf Orphanage.
Although Rose does consider the Lindstrom family as her own, she's well aware that she has a set of birth parents out there she's never met. Rose being Rose, she had always assumed that one of them was Bob Hope. He's not, by the way. A few episodes later in Little Sister, we meet Rose's sister and get a glimpse of what the dynamic between the two of them was like. Rose's sister Holly is played by Inga Swenson.
You had boyfriends, girlfriends, you were friends with every animal on the farm. I never learned how to make friends.
You never learned how to keep friends. You never thought of anybody but yourself. It's about time you stop looking around for other people to blame. This is your problem.
Rose is under no obligation to be friends with her sister, particularly in this episode where Holly deliberately tries to steal away Rose's friends. Although the other women had challenging relationships with their siblings, Rose seems the most level-headed in her approach, as the bad behavior seems entirely one-sided. Rose makes deliberate choices on what sort of family she chooses to spend her time with.
Oh, I always used to feel so guilty for not getting along with you. But that's over. Just because we're sisters doesn't mean we have to be friends. I'd like to be someday, but you're gonna have to make the first move.
In the two-parter, Home Again Rose in season 7, Rose suffers a heart attack, and while at the hospital, she suffers a second one, requiring triple bypass surgery. While she's in critical condition, only immediate family are allowed to see her. In this case, Rose is visited by her daughter Kirsten, played by Lee Garlington.
These two women love her like a sister, and I love your mother like she was my own.
Yeah, well, you're forgetting one thing, though. I'm her daughter. You're not her family. Why does everybody keep saying that? We share our lives together.
You share a house together.
When Kirsten goes to visit, Rose is looking for other people as well.
Kirsten, where are the girls?
Oh, they're too young to come to the hospital.
Not your girls. My girls. My girls aren't too young for anything.
Although Kirsten isn't terribly friendly to the other women at the hospital, they don't hold any grudges, particularly when Kirsten reveals that her insurance might not be able to cover the additional care Rose might need.
Even if she makes it, she may need a lot of physical therapy, and her insurance doesn't really cover that, and I don't know what we're gonna do.
Oh, don't you worry about that. Oh, honey, if Rose needs physical therapy, we'll just simply see that she gets it. Hell, that's why houses have mortgages.
You'd do that for her?
Of course.
More than just the women Rose has cheesecake with, the ladies of the Golden Girls are there to support her in whatever way she needs, especially now when she needs help the most. It's the sort of thing you would expect from a family. Rose thankfully recovers and she's able to return home.
You really think it's such a great idea to scream surprise at someone who just had heart surgery?
By choosing her family, Rose is a reflection of the essential qualities of a positive family dynamic. Support, both emotional and financial, are important to her in a family. In his book, Golden Girls Forever, Jim Colucci goes into detail about the idea of a family of choice, and hypothesizes that this is why the Golden Girls had such a strong following in the gay community, in which stigma often forced them into creating new families when their own were less accepting. It also certainly didn't hurt that the Golden Girls was very much ahead of the curve with regard to featuring LGBT characters and discussing issues that affected those communities. And one of the very first examples used Rose as a focal point. In season 2's Isn't It Romantic, Dorothy's friend Jean, played by Lois Nettleton, pays her a visit.
I wanted to make sure it was okay with you before I told
them. Oh, well, listen, Dorothy, I'm not embarrassed or ashamed of who I am. Hey, you know your friends better than I do. If you think they're the kind of people who can handle it, I'd prefer to tell them.
Here we are, ice cream cones with sugar cone hats for everybody.
It'll be our little secret.
Sophia reveals she already knew about Jean being a lesbian, and she tells Blanche the truth.
You aren't surprised?
Of course not. I mean, I've never known any personally, but isn't Danny Thomas one?
Not Lebanese, Blanche. Lesbian.
Jean doesn't adhere to any sort of stereotype about being a lesbian, and the role is, ironically, played straight. That is, without any comedic twists or quirks. It lets the regular cast play off her more effectively, and it makes her character seem more real when she confesses something to Dorothy.
I haven't met anyone as good and decent as Rose since Pat died. And I think I'm falling in love.
When Sophia gets sick, Dorothy offers Jean a spot in her room. But when Dorothy goes to bed early, Rose suggests Jean to spend the night in with her so Dorothy won't be woken up. The problem is Rose still has no idea Jean has fallen for her.
I'm quite fond of you.
I'm fond of you too.
After Jean opts not to share Rose's bed with her, the two of them talk it out in the morning.
See, Pat was the person that I planned to spend the rest of my life with. And when she died, I just felt so terribly alone, empty. I thought I could never care for anyone again until I met you. I just got very confused. I hope I didn't make you feel uncomfortable.
If I were, you know, like you, I think I'd be very flattered and proud that you thought of me that way.
Thank you, Rose.
A gay person being secret in love with a straight person is a very old trope. What's particularly interesting about this version of it, though, is how Jean isn't given the simple motivation of being attracted to a woman, but also some backstory about losing a partner and struggling to cope with that loss. Catching feelings quickly makes more sense in that context. She's also not presented as predatory or threatening in any way, just a person struggling with grief and in need of some love. Rose is the perfect object for her affections, easily the most naive of the principal cast, and having a lot in common with Jean to begin with, having both grown up on a farm, her sweet nature makes her very attractive. She also serves as a stand-in for the audience, being placed in this supposedly stressful situation to find out that even if it were to happen, it's something that can be settled with a talk and it's nothing to be afraid of. And that it doesn't even have to destroy a friendship. Just because someone is gay, it doesn't mean they're trying to convert someone who's straight. An anxiety that has often been reflected in less gay-friendly media. The script was a bit of a departure in that it wasn't written by someone on staff, but by a gay writer named Jeffrey Dutail, who sold it as a spec script. It was also shot largely as written. One change that was made was that, in the scene where Jean confesses to Rose, it was originally written with them sleeping in the same bed that night. In the episode, it was changed so that Jean slept on the sofa in Rose's room. In an interview, Dutail said, "I wonder if it had been NBC's standards and practices, but someone had obviously not wanted to leave the impression that Jean and Rose were going to stay in bed together for the rest of the night. I guess this was, after all, 1986. Rose is once again put into the center of a story affecting the gay community in season 5 episode 72 Hours, where she's contacted by the hospital about a blood transfusion she had for an operation a few years ago.
Seems you had a transfusion while you were there. The hospital thinks the blood may have contained HIV antibodies.
HIV? Wait a minute. You're talking about AIDS.
This episode was one of the first ever TV sitcoms to openly discuss AIDS, if not the very first, and it did so remarkably well. Instead of taking the obvious route of introducing the gay character for the women to befriend and learn a lesson from, it took an illness that, at the time, was thought of as exclusively affecting gay people and showing us that it affects everyone. Rose has to endure 3 days of waiting for her test results to come back, hence the title of 72 Hours. And during that wait, we watch firsthand how the very thought of possibly having AIDS created deep fear in everyone.
Well, come on, if that test turns out to be positive, you're not going to want to be around me, you or Miles or anybody.
In addition to the personal fears, this episode offers a lot of helpful information, all sourced from experts on HIV from UCLA. It's also based on a true story having happened to the mother of Tracy Gamble, the episode's writer. Throughout the episode, we see Sophia struggle with her own fear of being so close to Rose, not wanting to use the same dishes as her and writing giant R on them so she'd know which ones to avoid. This offers a moment of growth as well. While the episode was in production, Estelle Getty had been particularly uncomfortable playing Sophia that way. She was a major activist in the fight against AIDS, and working on stage in New York, she had a number of gay friends she thought of as children. When AIDS first appeared, she had to watch a number of these people pass away. At the time, she also had a nephew who was HIV positive. Halfway through the episode, Blanche confides in Rose that she had to get tested herself, and knowing that fear gives her the chance to be more empathetic. In an interview, Betty White noted, "Blanche was such a busy lady, but if it had been her story, it would have taken on a whole other color. If Blanche had been the one the episode focused on, it likely would have seemed more judgmental, as if AIDS was some kind of consequence for one's sex life, and it's exactly that sort of thinking that a line like this is responding to."
Damn it, why is this happening to me? I mean, this isn't supposed to happen to people like me. You must have gone to bed with hundreds of men. All I had was one innocent operation.
Hey, wait a minute. Are you saying this should be me and not you?
No, no, I'm just saying that I am a good person. Hell, I'm a goody two-shoes.
AIDS is not a bad person's disease, Rose. It is not God punishing people for their sins.
You're right, Blanche.
Well, you damn straight I'm right.
This line in particular resonated with the episode's editor, Peter DeBette. At the time, his partner Dean had tested positive for HIV. Unexpectedly, he was the one who was assigned to edit this episode, and he had a powerful reaction when he got to Blanche's line.
AIDS is not a bad person's disease, Rose. It is not God punishing people for their sins.
In an interview, he said, "My heart stopped. All of a sudden, unexpectedly, here was this woman on a sitcom I was cutting, talking about what I was feeling. I always admired Rue as a star and a friend anyway, but now a character I'd come to know so well was saying what I needed to hear. I broke down, of course. I had to stop working, and then I pulled myself together. And from that point, right in the middle of my partner's battle, I no longer thought that I was a bad person. The show changed me in that moment of desperation. And my God, did the world ever need that to be said?" The episode ends with Rose finding out she isn't HIV positive.
"People who test negative often need more counseling."
"Oh, I feel wonderful. I feel great."
"Well, evidently you had all the emotional support you needed."
The last line in particular highlights not just a practical concern for anyone waiting results from a medical test, but it serves as a message to the people at the time who may have had loved ones who were exposed to HIV. They needed to be treated with love and support, because as scary as it may be to be around someone with a mysterious and dangerous illness, it's even scarier to think you might have it yourself. In short, what a person who has a diagnosis like HIV needs is the love of a family. And at a time when families may not be considerate enough to offer that support, a family of one's choosing becomes crucial. It's an expression of solidarity, togetherness, and love. In a way, every episode of The Golden Girls was about an adoptive family, but it felt particularly earnest with Rose, partially from her own upbringing and her own genuine openness that displayed a level of love and trust that one would need to make a family work. And that lesson is learned throughout many encounters of people who weren't like them, but could be a kind of family all the same. The success of The Golden Girls motivated NBC to do what all networks like doing when they have a hit show, try to launch a spin-off. The first attempt was a backdoor pilot at the end of season 2 titled Empty Nests, about a neighbor of the ladies of the Golden Girls who is upset because her husband, a doctor, doesn't pay attention to her. The episode did not go over well and is likely the least popular one of the series. The entire concept would be changed, with the only holdover being the wacky neighbor played by David Leisure. A year and a half later, the first real spin-off of the Golden Girls would be launched, Empty Nest. It starred Richard Mulligan as Dr. Harry Weston, who you might remember seeing earlier in this video as the doctor who offered support to Dorothy when she was struggling with chronic fatigue syndrome. The premise was changed so that Dr. Weston was a recent widower and had two of his daughters move in with him, Carol played by Dinah Manoff and Barbara played by Christy McNichol. The wacky neighbor returned, only now instead of Oliver, he was named Charlie, a womanizing cruise ship employee. The principal cast for the first season was rounded out by Dr. Weston's nurse Laverne, played by Park Overall. And last, but certainly not least, was Dr. Weston's dog, Dreyfus, played by Bear the Dog. The series did fairly well, running for 6 seasons, and even led to a spin-off of its own, Nurses, which ran for 3 seasons. These 3 shows made up NBC's Saturday night lineup, one of the rare instances of a night dominated by shows that came from the same producer. It also offered opportunities for characters from each program to cross over to the others. The Golden Girls and Empty Nest had a number of episodes where characters would appear on each other's series. The most common guest star, though, was Dreyfus, who appeared on 5 different episodes of The Golden Girls, including one alongside his stand-in, Julio. This episode in particular may have raised some challenges, as Bear the Dog and Julio apparently had serious difficulties working together behind the scenes, despite both of them being otherwise very good boys. Each of the 4 ladies of the Golden Girls made guest appearances on Empty Nest, and Estelle Getty would eventually join the cast in the show's 5th and 6th season. Perhaps the most memorable crossover, though, was Hurricane Sunday, where on November 9th, 1991, a hurricane would blow through Miami, impacting all 3 shows. The Golden Girls kicked off the night with a 2-part special, including a cameo from Bea Arthur's real-life son, Matthew Sachs. The cameos continued as Sophia would show up on Empty Nest, and Rose would play a big part in the Nurses episode for that evening, getting in the middle of a knife fight.
Now, I'd like to know what is so terrible that it can't be settled over a nice cold glass of lemonade.
The episode proved a rating success and was repeated a few months later with Full Moon Over Miami, where the 3 shows once again crossed over on February 29th, 1992, celebrating Leap Day. Both Empty Nest and Nurses continued after the Golden Girls finished up its run, though ratings declined for both and they were eventually canceled. There was another Golden Girls spinoff that began after the main series wrapped up, though I'll be getting to that one a little later.
So what? I'm old. I'm supposed to be colorful.
Picture it. Miami, 1986. Sophia Petrillo is quietly sipping her coffee while her housemates are having a friendly chat. Someone gives her an opening, and she pounces with a cutting remark.
Mel and I were meant to be together.
I wish I could say the same for your thighs. Tonight.
When it comes to Sophia's one-liners, it might appear that no thought is being put into who they hurt, but Estelle Getty drew a line between the types of jokes she would and wouldn't do.
I have a thing about gratuitous pain. I have a thing about using humor to really hurt. I remember once they wanted me to do a line about, and my husband, the end of the tagline was, and my husband said, you do that and I'll beat the hell out of you. And I said, I won't do that line. I don't make jokes about beating. They said, oh, it's just that. I said, I won't do it.
Sophia is the oldest of the Golden Girls, and episodes that focus on her emphasize that fact, such as season 1's The Heart Attack, where Sophia believes she's having one.
I thought I was a goner. It's incredible. You think you're dying. You feel death enter your body. A doctor comes. He says you're fine. You're ready to swim the English Channel.
Another example is season 5's Clinton Avenue Memories, where Sophia's fading memory makes her feel like she's losing part of her life all over again.
I hate getting old. You always seem to be losing something. First it's your eyesight. Then people are telling you to turn down the TV set when you can barely hear it. And you could live with that. But this, they're trying to take something from me that I just won't give. I can't let this happen, Dorothy. I can't lose my Sal. Not again.
These moments can be tough to watch, with your heart breaking for Sophia, but what keeps them from getting too heavy is how tough she is. As hard as her life is getting, you can't help but imagine she'll find a way to pull through it. Clinton Avenue Memories was particularly fitting for Estelle Getty, who often had trouble remembering her lines. Rather than upsetting the actress, having her difficulty dramatized, the writers for this episode report she was very happy with it, and her performance in this episode earned her an Emmy nomination. The Golden Girls also highlights how Sophia's age doesn't stop her from having adventures of her own. In season 4's The Days and Nights of Sophia Petrillo, we get a glimpse of what it's like for her when she goes to the grocery store to buy a nectarine.
Hey, you got any decent nectarines?
There's nothing wrong with those nectarines.
Please, I got a bowl of wax bananas that'll be ripe before these,
You're crazy. This nectarine is beautiful. I never saw a more perfect piece of fruit.
No? Then try kissing my behind. It's a real peach.
They're giving you a hard time, too.
Nah, I just can't pick out a decent nectarine. This way they do it for me.
Why don't you just ask for help?
Help? You know who helps old broads like us? Boy Scouts and cartoons. We gotta look after ourselves.
Not only does Sophia make an adventure out of buying fruit, she also helps her friend get a refund for a bad cut of meat. Later in the day, she leads a band, and then volunteers at the hospital.
Sophia, once they goofed up my blood with that transfusion, there wasn't anything anyone could do. No one's ever beat it, Sophia.
But someday they will, and it could be tomorrow, and it could be you. I believe that, and you're gonna believe that. Because right now, today, that's all we got. Hope!
And a nectarine.
And a nectarine.
It's all in a day's work for Sophia.
What did you do, Ma?
What did I do today? What I do every day. I bought a nectarine.
Sophia's living life as best she can, still having fun and excitement, and even standing up to an injustice. It reveals her as a force to be reckoned with, and not to be simply dismissed as a frail old lady. Even with her body and mind failing her, she manages to accentuate what strengths she still has to make her life a better one. We see more of this just a few episodes later in the two-parter, Sophia's Wedding. In the first part, after her friend Esther Weinstock dies, Sophia is reunited with Esther's husband Max, played by Jack Gilford. Sophia and her late husband Sal were close with the Weinstocks, and together opened a failed pizza knish stand back in Brooklyn. Sophia mistakenly thought Max was the reason it went under, when the truth is he was taking the blame for Sal. With that misunderstanding cleared up, Sophia and Max get close.
I am speechless!
We're getting married!
I am very lightheaded.
A fun detail of this episode is that you can see a young Quentin Tarantino, who had yet to become a famous director, performing as one of the Elvis impersonators. Once married, Sophia and Max reopen that pizza knish stand, this time in Miami, to try and relive their dream. And after a few bumps, their business is a hit. Sadly, the shop burns down the next day because of the pizza oven. Sophia and Max also realize their marriage might have been rushed into.
Are you in love with me the way you were with Esther?
No. Do you love me the way you did Sal?
I thought I did, but now I think I might have confused a great friendship with a great love. This is the kind of mistake you're supposed to make when you're 19. It gives me hope to think you can be just as dopey at 82.
This two-parter was incredibly sweet, though more importantly, it's another example of the sort of adventure-filled life that Sophia is living. In this two-parter, she ends a long-standing feud, falls in love, gets married, starts a business, ends a business, and gets a separation. All of that in just two episodes. And much like her trip to buy a nectarine, Sophia doesn't go on these adventures alone. She enriches the lives of the people around her, making their life just a bit more exciting or comforting, particularly older folks who may be under the impression that there isn't much left for them to do in the world. There are many of these episodes, such as the one where Sophia convinces a friend not to take her own life, or rescues another friend who's staying in an underfunded nursing home. My favorite of these, though, is season 3's Old Friends, where Sophia makes a new friend, Alvin Newcastle, played by Joe Seneca.
Hey, Alvin! I have an enormous veal and pepper sandwich here. I couldn't possibly finish it. You want half? I made it fresh this morning.
Sounds more interesting than the tangerine I got.
Prepare yourself for a rare treat.
Hey, I don't even know your name.
Sophia. Sophia Petrillo.
Italian?
Take one bite of the sandwich and you tell me.
Sophia later learns that Alvin might be more sensitive than she first thought, and we see her offer some rare warmth.
I'm asking about Edna.
Edna?
Your wife! Oh, hey. I'm sorry. I guess I just can't take a hint. There's some things about Salvador I still have trouble talking about. Of course, other things I'm not allowed to talk about unless I want the Scarpoli family to put out a contract on me. Hey, I made up that last part trying to lighten the moment. I'm sorry, Alvin. Don't cry. That That's okay. You cry all you want.
The next time they meet, Alvin seems to be another person.
You're always doing this kind of thing. You're never thinking about anybody but yourself.
What are you talking about?
You know what I'm talking about. I didn't take the wrong bus. That dumbass driver went the wrong way, a different way, and you know it.
What the hell's the matter with you? Alvin! Alvin!
Dorothy, having spoken to Alvin's daughter.
Ma, please, will you let me say what I have to say?
Maybe I don't want to hear what you have to say. Maybe I'm happy not knowing anything.
Or maybe you know already.
I'm not stupid. I could see there was something about Alvin that wasn't right.
Ma, he has Alzheimer's disease.
Within the next couple of months, he's going to be sent to New York to stay with his nephew, a doctor who can give him special care.
You know, Dorothy, people think if you live to be my age, you should be grateful just to be alive. Well, that's not how it works. You need a reason to get up in the morning, and sometimes even after you find one, life can turn right around and spit in your face.
I'm sorry, Ma.
As far as very special episodes go, this is one of my favorites. It was a simple story about making and losing a friend, but more importantly, it was about life needing a purpose, even in old age. It isn't trying to use a rare experience to tug at the heartstrings, but instead serve as a reminder that one day we may all be in Sophia's shoes, or maybe even Alvin's, getting older and needing something more than being grateful to still be alive. Her performance in this episode earned Estelle Getty her Emmy Award. Sophia Petrillo is more than just some comedic relief. She's an aspirational figure, someone who embodies the sort of old age most people would want to have, one that acknowledges the frailties while refusing to let go of the important things that make life worth living. If Dorothy represents resisting a system that places older women lower on the hierarchy, and Blanche represents learning how to survive in that place, and Rose represents the compassion needed to fuel both of those reactions, Sophia represents a fourth part of this dynamic, an awareness of the changing world around us and the drive to do something about it. Sophia is a capable woman who can make the most of her life, but she also realizes it's important to help her friends do the same. In this way, she embodies much of what the three other women of the Golden Girls represent, while serving as a role model at the same time. To continuously fight to make the world around her a better one, a spirit that manifests itself throughout the series towards higher calls to action, calls that could change society itself.
45 cents for one lousy nectarine? What's inside a pit or a pearl?
One of the episodes where Sophia is trying to rescue a friend from a particularly brutal nursing home, season 4 is Sophia's choice, we find out this evil nursing home isn't so poorly run on purpose.
Sunny Pastures doesn't operate at a profit. Our patients' Social Security and Medicare pay most of our bills. Government subsidies pick up the slack so we can meet minimum standards.
Well, then maybe minimum standards aren't enough.
Right again. And this year, the government's made cutbacks. We're operating in the red and doing the best we can.
Throughout the series, there are many moments like this about the financial insecurity people feel in old age. Rose is the focal point in two important instances, the two times she loses her job. The first is season 1's job hunting. This episode is a bit of an anomaly, as it was produced very early in the show's run, but not aired until much later in the season. In it, Rose loses her job at the counseling center, though in future episodes, she seems to have gotten it back. This seems like one of those plot points that sitcoms conveniently forget. However, the episode does helpfully show us the financial realities of Dorothy and Rose.
Rose, you and I are in the same boat. If we miss a couple of paychecks, we are in big trouble.
Thank God I had the foresight to marry money.
Tramp.
Sophia is in similar shape, often having to ask Dorothy for money to fund her many escapades. This series is about women trying to find a life while struggling to survive in a world that still has a price tag on it. As Rose struggles to find work, she begins to feel the way the world sees her.
I've had dozens of job interviews since the center closed. No one wants me. I can't afford not to work, and I need something to do with my life. I never think of myself as old, but everyone else does. Maybe I am old, old and useless, and terrified.
Youth and usefulness are closely intertwined, and how that impacts employment combines with all the external pressures these women face telling them to act a certain way at their age. In season 5's Rose Fights Back, Rose finds out that the company that employed her late husband Charlie is cutting off his pension, meaning she needs to find a higher paying job to cover her expenses. We once again get a sense of the economic anxiety she faces.
You know, every morning when I leave the house, I see this bag lady going through the garbage over on 135th Street. She has everything she owns piled in one of those old shopping carts. What did she do to get herself into a fix like that?
I thought, well, she must be lazy. Or she must be pretty stupid to let something like this happen to her. But the truth is, she's me.
Rose's difficulties weren't because of any character flaws, but the circumstances of her life. In another episode, it was revealed her late husband Charlie had made some mistakes as a businessman and lost much of their savings. And then his early death meant Rose was left out on her own. And now with his pension gone, even with her living a modest life, she's on the brink of losing everything. In this episode, luckily for Rose, she gets a new job working as an assistant to a TV journalist. And even though it ends with Rose saying she would have landed on her feet anyway, it seems easier for her to say that when things have already worked out. Rose, by the way, goes on to be a wonderful journalist, particularly in the season 6 episode, Melodrama, where she ignores the obvious sensationalism of an armed robbery to get to the real story of the dog show.
Rose Nyland for Channel 8 News here at the Miami Pet Dog Expo, and I am an eyewitness to something shocking. People who look like their dogs.
The women of the Golden Girls get their closest glimpse of economic catastrophe in the season 4 episode, Brother, Can You Spare That Jacket?, where a wacky story of trying to chase down a winning lottery ticket in an old jacket leads the women to a homeless shelter, and things take a very non-wacky turn. Each of the women makes a new friend while looking for the jacket. Blanche meets Kenny, a young man with a doctorate who cracked under intense academic pressure. Rose meets Ben, a man who was deemed too old to get a new job, while Dorothy and Sophia meet Sophia's old friend Ida, played by Herta Ware.
What happened, Ida? I didn't know. Nobody told me that it cost money to get old. I just figured that was one thing you'd get for free. It isn't. The home costs money. The doctors cost money. Medicine costs money. You know, I always thought it was sad. I outlived my whole family. But I never knew it was going to be a punishment.
Sophia tries to offer some comfort to Ida.
Ida, I know it's rough by yourself. I count my blessings that I have my Dorothy to look after me. But you can't give up. People care. They really do. Good people won't let this kind of suffering go on. You just gotta hang in there till tomorrow.
Sophia, it is tomorrow.
When the women find the lottery ticket, they give it to the priest who runs the homeless shelter, knowing that this small gesture isn't much more than that. It highlights how acts of personal charity aren't nearly enough in the face of a social crisis like homelessness. What was particularly thoughtful was that this episode didn't fixate alone on the pain of being homeless, but instead allowed these people to tell their stories, giving them ownership of one of the few things they have left. These very special episodes tend to fall flat in most sitcoms, but The Golden Girls is carried by excellent writing and performances to make them a natural fit, particularly when it ties into the themes of aging and insisting on being part of the world. If the four women of The Golden Girls are insisting to society not to be ignored, episodes like these are a sharp rebuke that it's not just an attitude change that lets someone hold on to the meaning in their life in old age. There also needs to be a change to society that allows older folks to keep living that meaningful life, even as opportunities seem to be vanishing all around them. Because one day we'll all be older, and can we say with certainty that we won't end up like Ida? And even if we're lucky, does that mean ending up like Sophia, who gets by thanks to the support of her daughter? Maybe we should just go with the show's subtle hint of letting Rose lead some kind of uprising, as seen in the season 3 episode, Letter to Gorbachev. Marx, Lenin, and now Rose. Well, she would probably have done a better job than Stalin. After 7 seasons, ratings for The Golden Girls had started to slip slightly, with the show's 7th season falling out of the top 10 most watched for the first time. That said, it was still a strong performer and the heart of NBC's Saturday night lineup. Even with that success, Bea Arthur was looking to leave the show. Though she had considered leaving the show during its 5th season, she was eventually convinced to stay on for 2 more. But the producers couldn't convince her to stay any longer, and she decided to exit the series with season 7. Although this would not be the last we would see of these characters, The Golden Girls itself would come to an end on May 9th, 1992, with the two-parter, One Flew Out of the Cuckoo's Nest. Blanche's Uncle Lucas, played by Leslie Nielsen, stops by for a visit. Blanche, not having any time for her uncle because of a date, passes him off to Dorothy. The two of them try to prank Blanche by pretending to fall in love, only to genuinely fall for one another.
Dorothy, will you marry me for real?
For real?
Oh, yes, Lucas. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
They're a perfect fit in more than a few ways.
We're both adults and capable of a caring, warm relationship.
How was the sex?
So good we named it!
On the day of the wedding, Stan briefly shows up to give Dorothy his blessing, and the wedding goes off without a hitch. Although it seemed like Sophia would be going with Dorothy at first, she instead decides to stay in Miami.
I'm not going with you, pussycat. I'm staying here with the girls.
The girls?
Rose, Blanche, whatever they are. We discussed it after the wedding, and pussycat, they need me.
Ma, I need you.
No, no, you need to be married now, alone. Frankly, I think I was in the way the first time.
Oh, no, you weren't. Yes, you were.
And they say their goodbyes.
Your friendship was something I never expected at this point in my life, and I could never have asked for a better surprise.
That's how we feel, too.
And Dorothy leaves.
I love you. Always.
Twice.
Oh, God, I love you so much. Oh, Dorothy!
Okay, maybe one more time.
Oh, God, I love you!
And the final lines of the series are...
You'll always be my sisters. Always.
The finale of the series felt like an ending without being conclusive. This quartet of women was being split up, but their stories weren't final. This is a vindication of its theme, though. How can you possibly make a series about how life doesn't end at a certain age, and then finish it with an ending that makes it seem like their lives have concluded? Dorothy's departure is a new beginning for her, and a change for all her friends. A sad one in some ways, and an exciting one in others. And Dorothy is clear in that what prepared her for the new things in her life were the friends who made her a stronger person. It reinforced the theme of women supporting each other that runs throughout the series. Dorothy's strong will is her personal trait, but her feminism isn't one of standing alone. It's one of sisterhood where her friends support her and give her the confidence she needs to jump into this marriage. Blanche initially resisted the romance, but her being the first to notice was crucial, helping Dorothy and Lucas realize the connection between them. Blanche is quite wise when it comes to love and romance. Rose is the reminder of family, particularly one that is made rather than inherited. Her journey in the episode was thinking she had lost her place, only to realize she would always have one with her new family, not replacing the old, but creating a second loving one, much in the way Dorothy is. Sophia is a reminder that life never stops having new adventures until you give up on them. Dorothy says as much when she's saying goodbye to her.
I do want you to know that without you and Blanche and Rose, I never would have been ready to try.
One interesting bit of trivia regarding this episode is that it mimics the life of the show's producers, Paul Witt and Susan Harris. They had played a prank on the show's other producer, Tony Thomas, by pretending to have fallen for one another, only to realize they had feelings for one another themselves and eventually would be married. When the Golden Girls went off the air, it wasn't quite the end for the characters, though. There was a spin-off that is, in some ways, an unofficial eighth season. After the Golden Girls ended, the show's producers pitched a spin-off in which Blanche, Rose, and Sophia would purchase a hotel together, calling this new show The Golden Palace. Because of the Golden Girls' declining ratings, NBC was hesitant to commit to the series, offering to buy 13 episodes, half a regular season. CBS offered to buy a full 24-episode season, so the producers took that offer, putting the show on CBS's new Friday night lineup. Although Bea Arthur could never be replaced, the show's cast did have a few additions. Don Cheadle played the role of Roland Wilson, the hotel manager and straight man for the series. The hotel chef, Chuy Castillos, would be played by Cheech Marin, inspired by a character from an earlier version of the Golden Girls pilot, in which the gay chef Coco had been Latino. Billy L. Sullivan would play Roland's foster son, Oliver, though Oliver only appeared in one-third of the episodes, and was written out of the series by the 14th episode. With much of the same production team, The Golden Palace feels like an extension of the main series, though without Dorothy, a balance between the characters is lost. Cheech Marin and Don Cheadle do the best they can, but the show doesn't seem able to decide whether or not it'll be something completely new or a retread of The Golden Girls. Although initially the ratings were good, they declined over the year and the show was canceled after one season, along with CBS's Friday Night of Comedy. There were some highlights worth mentioning, though. The episode about the Confederate flag brought up a conversation that had been happening for decades to mainstream television, and one we're still grappling with today.
This flag, Mrs. Devereaux, is not about college football games or quilting bees or fried chicken on Sunday. It's about colleges that won't let me in. It's about companies that won't hire me. It is about crosses being burnt on people's lawns today. Not in the evil past, Blanche, today. And not just in the South, all over. The North is just as bad.
Damn Yankees.
There was also the episode about greyhound dogs, raising awareness that they were often killed once they stopped winning races. There were also a few genuinely hilarious moments, such as a two-parter where Dorothy returned, giving us this great moment.
Group hug, everybody! I've never really been as into this as they are. I gotta get back.
The Golden Palace came to an end on May 7th, 1993. The Golden Girls left a long-standing legacy, being a unique show even by today's standards, highlighting the lives of older women. It was built on strong performances that won every member of its cast an Emmy.
Picture it, California, 1988. This is such a big thrill, and I know that I can't take too much time, but I want to thank the immediate world.
Estelle and Rue and Bea and I all thank you. We're a match set. You can't split us up.
The Golden Girls also won Outstanding Comedy Series for its first two seasons and Writing and Directing for a Comedy Series. Throughout its run, it picked up 11 Emmy wins across 58 nominations. Also notable was that Betty White and Estelle Getty were nominated for Emmys for all seven seasons the show was on the air. There were a number of international versions of the show, such as the English version called Brighton Bells. There was also an Israeli version, a Dutch version, a Russian version, a Greek version, two Spanish versions, a Turkish version, an Egyptian version, and though I couldn't find footage for them, there was also a Chilean version, a Philippine version, and a Portuguese version. Following the end of The Golden Girls, Bea Arthur would make a handful of guest appearances on TV shows such as Malcolm in the Middle and Curb Your Enthusiasm. She returned to the stage in a one-woman show titled An Evening with Bea Arthur, and it sometimes went by the name And Then There's Bea. On April 25th, 2009, she passed away at the age of 86 due to lung cancer. Rue McClanahan would continue to be a prolific actress following The Golden Girls, appearing in guest spots in a number of TV shows and movies, and many people might remember her from her appearance in Starship Troopers. In 1997, she learned she had breast cancer, but luckily she was able to survive that diagnosis. Sadly though, on June 3rd, 2010, at the age of 76, she suffered a brain hemorrhage and passed away. Estelle Getty would continue to act in a number of roles following the end of the show, notably starring alongside Sylvester Stallone in Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. She would take the character of Sophia Petrillo to Empty Nest, appearing in its final two seasons, and Sophia would even show up in an episode of Blossom. Getty struggled with health issues towards the end of The Golden Girls. Her condition would continue to deteriorate over the years, and she was diagnosed with dementia with Lewy bodies. She passed away on July 22nd, 2008. Betty White continued to appear in a number of TV shows and movies following The Golden Girls. Most remarkably though, an advertisement during the 2010 Super Bowl propelled her popularity to new heights. She became the oldest host ever on Saturday Night Live at the age of 88 and would go on to co-star in six seasons on Hot in Cleveland. Sadly, on December 31st, 2021, Betty White passed away at the age of 99 due to natural causes. The Golden Girls reflected back to its audience the troubles of the world with messages that it should be fixed. We see this in issues related to the LGBT community, economic anxiety, and the challenges of making it through your later years. There's an irony as it's typically the children who are expected to be the voices of reason, cutting through the nonsense of older generations, but this reinforces the idea that there are older folks who see the problems as well and are willing to help stand up to make the world a better place. And it's damning on all of us that many of the problems that this series highlights still persist today. There hasn't been a show quite like The Golden Girls since it aired. Many have adopted the quartet dynamic with four personalities playing off of each other, including shows such as Seinfeld, Will and Grace, Sex and the City, and others that have that four-person dynamic. But when it comes to characters' ages, The Golden Girls still stands alone. Women in their 50s and 60s never quite dominated in a sitcom the way The Golden Girls did. Maybe because the issues a show precisely like this one raised tended to make people feel uncomfortable. The idea of an old woman being so economically desperate that she is reduced to being homeless does not stand like the standard fare of a sitcom. And the success of The Golden Girls is because it transcended those realities on the strength of its writing and performances. It managed to be thought-provoking without being preachy, largely because it was just so damn entertaining. The Golden Girls was fearless, always offering humor, but not afraid to pull at the heartstrings. It delved into taboo subjects and never lost sight of its mission to charm the audience. It was, in many ways, the perfect vehicle for raising awareness about topics related to feminism, gay rights, and economic disparity. The ladies of the Golden Girls are four of a kind, and sadly, we may never see a kind like theirs again, but we'll always have Miami in 1985. I had so much fun working on this video. The Golden Girls is a show that absolutely holds up and is just so charming and delightful. It was a lot of fun until the very end. After I first recorded this video, literally the next day, Betty White passed away. A loss for pretty much anyone who enjoyed her work. Though I have to say, after having spent months watching every episode of Golden Girls and countless interviews and documentaries in which she was featured, it hits a little differently. It really gave me a sense of the loss of such a tremendous talent. In lieu of the regular calls to action I put at the end of the video, instead I'm going to suggest everyone donate what little they can to one of the animal charities links below. Betty White was a huge animal lover and a lovely person. Thank you everyone for watching, and thank you to all of the Golden Girls for the wonderful memories.
We gotta go. I hate to leave. I've never seen a show like this before.